A few years ago, I read a National Geographic article about the lost colony mystery having been solved by a Hatteras Island archaeological team. It seemed to be an interesting idea, but just that, an idea. The History Channel was putting out a program that followed another theory, the one about the Roanoke colonists having gone inland toward Edenton. Both ideas seemed plausible. But, being skeptical, I chalked it all up to new theories being applied to an age-old mystery that would most likely never be solved. But then I kept seeing material coming out of Hatteras. Each year, more finds brought more attention to the Outer Banks. Then in August 2020, I read an article in a local newspaper that reviewed a new book. That book, The Lost Colony in Hatteras Island, written by historian and archaeologist Scott Dawson, had drawn quite a lot of attention, and is continuing to receive a lot of coverage. Because of that, I had to reach out to talk about the work being done on Hatteras. Scott Dawson is a Hatteras Island native. He grew up hearing local stories about the Croatoan, the lost colonists, and Hatteras history. He even worked a few local history jobs when he was younger. It was at one of those jobs that Scott's interest in the lost colony story was piqued. His reading of primary source materials, together with his understanding of local geography, convinced him that the Roanoke Island colonists weren't lost. They were abandoned. To prove his theory, Scott began looking for clues, which then turned into full-on archaeological digs. Soon Scott founded the Croatoan Archaeological Society, which has since partnered with the University of Bristol's Dr. Mark Horton for the majority of work being done on Hatteras. So much has been done in the last decade, and Scott's new book recalls that work. The book also alludes to more discovery to come, as new leads will be explored in the future. Some of my listeners, as well as a few academic naysayers, may not believe that Scott's work has solved the seemingly unsolvable mystery of Roanoke Island. I must admit that I was quite a bit skeptical as well. But Scott's work makes a compelling case that the mystery was no mystery at all, and the colonists were never lost. They were indeed abandoned. But regardless of where one's opinion may fall, after listening to this episode and reading Scott's book, there must at least be this one takeaway. Namely, the story that we thought we all knew was a false tale in that it focused attention away from Croatoan, or as we know the island today, Hatteras. Almost for that historic retelling alone, Scott's work deserves attention and praise.
Well, Scott Dawson, welcome to the Virginia History Podcast. I'm excited to talk with you. You got a new book coming out about, or actually it's already out. Came out, what, in April?
It was supposed to come out in April, but COVID pushed it to June 15th.
Yeah. Why don't you give us a little bit of background about yourself and how you got involved with what we call the Lost Colony, or what most people call the Lost Colony, and tell us your story.
All right. I've been a historian for over 20 years. I'm the president of the Croatoan Archaeological Society. Work's been featured in New York Times, National Geographic, Discovery Channel, Travel Channel, Inside Edition, blah, blah, blah. What I'm excited to talk to you about today, right now, is this new discovery of a 433-year-old mystery that we've now solved of an abandoned English colony, which we've recently dug up with a team of professionals in a Native American village on Hatteras Island in North Carolina. And as you said, the mystery is usually referred to as the lost colony. There's a lot of myth. There's a lot of misinformation out there on this subject. That's what always happens when history becomes popular in fiction, like what Jamestown deals with Pocahontas, or Blackbeard because of all the pirate movies, or Billy the Kid. It's not uncommon for real history to get buried by mythology. So we were dealing with a little bit of that with the Lost Colony as well.
Sure. Let's jump in on some of the history here. Go ahead and start summarizing the Lost Colony story as we know it. I shouldn't say as we know it, but as it's been said for at least 433 years. Tell us a bit about that story.
Well, what I would say is that the mythology is really a 20th century phenomenon, is that the Lost Colony myth has not existed for 433 years. It's existed since exactly 1937 when the Lost Colony play began. It's an outdoor play, and it's a play, so people shouldn't take it as history, but somehow that's what happened. And the play was a really big deal when it first came out. President Roosevelt was there. Andy Griffith was acting in it at one point. And a lot of misinformation has spewed out of that play, and unfortunately, it's wiggled its way into the school system. So the myth goes like this. They start the story in the middle, kind of like Star Wars, right? And they have the fourth voyage, which is the Lost Colony, and they don't tell you about the first, second, or third one at all. And they have 117 English colonists that come over to Roanoke Island, and they're left there because the governor, John White, had to go back to England to get resupplies. And he told them, if you leave, write down the name of where you're going on a tree. And if you leave for danger, put a cross under it. He doesn't come back for 3 years because of a lot of blah, blah, blah. And when he gets back, he finds the word Croatoan carved out on a tree. And the letter CRO carved on another tree. And then in the mythology, no one knows what this cryptic message means. Dun, 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 they're lost. Which, of course, is totally incorrect. And I would go one further and say disrespectful. It is Croatoan, of course, is Hatteras Island, but it's also a Native American tribe that the English had been interacting with for 3 years. They had a Croatoan man with them in the colony named Manio, who'd been to England twice and spoke English. It's like the Squanto of the South. When you say that Croatoan's a mysterious word and no one knows what it means, you just erased an entire tribe's history. It would be no different than right saying the word Cherokee was carved on a tree and no one's ever heard of them, you know? Right. So it's ridiculous. So that was kind of my motivation to get involved, because I'm from Croatoan and I am related to that tribe, and a little bit more than I have a little bit more native blood than, say, Elizabeth Warren, right? So I used to work as a historical interpreter on a 16th century vessel. In North Carolina, we have a little park. It's called Festival Park. It's kind of like Colonial Jamestown, where people dress up in period clothing from that time and kind of tell you the story of what happened. And they gave us this script, and they edited out huge chunks of it. And they're like, you're not allowed to talk about the Lost Colony at all. You're not allowed to say this. You're not allowed to say that. You have to stick to this thing. I said, well, this is kind of detrimental to the truth. Like, you've cut out so much stuff that we're basically lying to the public. And I never followed that script for years that I worked there. And I got away with it because people loved me. But, you know, I'd ham it up, firing guns and all that stuff. But they gave me the real sources, because I said, where can you get the real deal? Because the first thing you learn, even as an undergrad, is if you're going to be a historian, you've got to get to the primary sources. That's step one, is read that. And I did. And the story is crystal clear. There's nothing ambiguous about it at all. I had no idea the depths that we had been lied to. And when I found out the real story, I knew exactly where the colony had gone. I think being from that island, you've got kind of intimate knowledge of the geography, and a lot of what, when you're reading it, you can pick up on things that, say, somebody from Ireland or Nebraska reading it wouldn't catch. And so I started going out to construction sites, and when they would dig, the Indian villages on the island are well known, because it's not like they disappeared in 1587. whenever somebody built a house there, I would go and look through the piles of dirt that they piled up with a bulldozer and pick out all these native artifacts. And we were finding, I was finding a lot of English artifacts too. I photographed them and was writing emails to all these professors and saying, look, somebody needs to come down here and take a look at this. We need some professionals, if nothing else, just to preserve this Native American history before it's under some 10-bedroom house with a pool, which is what was going on. And thank God, Dr. Mark Horton, University of Bristol from England, came over and started digging with us, and it exploded, and we ended up finding them, which I'll get into all the finds later. But I think what's important for people to understand first is the history.
Sure. So can you give us some of the reasons for the colonization attempts, why they started and what the motivation was?
Sure. I think the best way to start is at the first voyage instead of starting in the middle like the myth. So in 1584, Spain and England were on the brink of war. They were in a double proxy war against each other, and they were robbing each other on the high seas. War had not been declared. It would be declared the next year in 1585, but it was obvious that they were going to go to war. The Queen Elizabeth of England had a personal hatred of King Philip II of Spain and vice versa. He had actually been married to her older sister, Mary, who we know as Bloody Mary. And that's a whole other story, but England at the time was not this superpower like we think of now. They were not a weak nation, but they were a lot weaker than Spain. And one of the things a weaker nation can do to a stronger nation and kind of level the playing field is to rob them on the high seas. So the English motivation for coming to the New World, at least in the beginning, was primarily to rob the Spanish. And Hatteras Island, if you look at it on a map, it jets out. It's that big elbow sticking out on the East Coast. It always gets hit by hurricanes. Mm. Most people have heard of Cape Hatteras from the Weather Channel.
Right.
but it sits right on the Gulf Stream, and hurricanes follow warm water, and the Spanish would follow that same Gulf Stream ocean current to go back to Spain. They're already in the Caribbean, in Mexico, and Florida. They'd been in the New World for 92 years. So they would follow that Gulf Stream current back to Spain, and Hatteras Island is a perfect place and perfect 90 degree angle to ambush them as they came around the corner, just getting punched right in the face. So it was a perfect place to rob Spanish ships. Secondary to that, any natural resources, any good trade they got from the natives they met, if they can make a profit off of that, great. And they did, and the English did not find gold or silver, but they did get pearls, and they got tobacco, and they got leather from deer skins, which was actually worth a lot back then. And so they made a little bit of money doing that as well. But their main reason was just to stick it to the Spanish.
And Hatteras is a great vantage point, right? It overlooks pretty far out to sea, so they could see ships coming. As you mentioned in the book, they could see them coming and going pretty easily.
And not only that, but on the other side of Hatteras Island is a shallow sound to escape into. So the bigger Spanish ships, the big warships that have a deep draft, they can't go in the sound. So you could kind of hit and run, and there's nothing they could do about it. And pirates used the Outer Banks for centuries after this for the exact same reasons. Mm-hmm. Hatteras Island is literally shaped like a right angle, an elbow. And if you're up on a hill, you can see people coming, and they cannot see you around that elbow. And it goes whether they're coming from the north or the south. You can play the same trick. It's just a perfect setup for it.
Sure. So it makes more sense that the English were looking at Hatteras, not Manteo or Roanoke Island, as it's called.
Yeah, they didn't care about Roanoke Island at all until the second voyage. During the first voyage, they only spent one day on Roanoke Island. That was it. They were there the entire time that they were living there. They were on Hatteras Island. And the Indians that they brought with them back to England, Manio and Wanchese, even though the towns today, Manio and Wanchese, are on Roanoke Island, neither one of those Indians was from Roanoke Island. Right. Neither one of them was a chief. They never fought each other. Like, all that stuff just is from the play. But they are real people, but they're from Hatteras. And the second voyage that came in is the one that put people on Roanoke Island, but they started on Hatteras Island as well. And it wasn't until a couple months into being here that they started to move some of their troops to Roanoke Island. And the whole reason for that was because they went to war with an Indian nation called Secotan. We're on the adjacent mainland near Roanoke Island. And they end up murdering a chief and burning down a village and kidnapping and beheading and doing what England does. And Roanoke Island was a strategic military target fighting the natives on the mainland because of where it was. But it was terrible for fighting the Spanish because you can't see the ocean. It's tucked in the sound. And so they always had some people living on Hatteras Island, and then they had some on Roanoke Island once they got into a dispute with the Secotan Indians, who the Croatoan Indians also hated and begged the English to attack from day one. So that part of the story, I think, has been neglected pretty bad. What's happened a lot of times is these different nations get painted with one giant broad brush and are just called Indians. Right. And so you can't possibly understand the fate of the lost colony without understanding this dynamic of what was going on between the Croatoan, the Secotan, and the English.
So what was going on between the Croatoan and the Secotan then?
So 2 years before the English got there, so 1582, 2 years before the English arrived, the Secotan and the Croatoan had just finished a war, and they were nobody won. They just decided to stop fighting, and they were celebrating it with a feast on Croatoan. So they invited a lot of the Secotan Barawances, like a councilman, the higher ups in the Secotan government and their chief, to come over to the island and celebrate. And they did, and they had a feast, and they were dancing, and at the end, the Croatoan went into their machikomek, which is like a temple. You're not allowed to have weapons in the temple. It's a respect thing, kind of like not bringing guns inside of a church, right? And while they were in there, the Secotan had hidden weapons and pulled them out and murdered a bunch of Croatoan, and they took about 30 women off as slaves. So the Croatoan were super angry about this, and they told the English about it right away. And they promised them, look, if you help us fight them and beat them, because they saw the English armor and guns and swords, so that you could beat them easily, especially with our help. And if you do, all the pearls, all the tobacco, all the things that the English had shown interest in, they promised them warehouses of it. If you would only help us, we'll give you all of that. We don't care about that. We just want revenge. And the English didn't want to do it. In the beginning, they like, nah, we're not, you know, we've got our own enemies, Spain. And they didn't want to get involved in a local dispute like that. They did, and they did eventually get suckered into it. But in that first voyage, there was like a small, I guess you'd call it like a honeymoon period in 1584, where they got along with everybody. It didn't last, though.
What changed that in the 1585 mission, then?
The 1585 mission, what changed it is two things. The guy that was supposed to be in charge, a man named Richard Grenville, is pretty reasonable and educated person. He's related to Sir Walter Raleigh, and he was in charge in the very, very beginning, but they had seven ships, and one of them wrecked at Ocracoke, which is the island that was called Waukegan back then. It's just south of Hatteras, and it was the biggest ship, and it had most of the supplies on it, and it had a lot of sugar that they had stolen from the Spanish on the way over out of the Caribbean. And they lost almost all of that, and they were counting on that to pay back the investors. So they had a change of plans, and they took all of the ships and all of the men except for 105 out of 600. And they left and went and raided the Azores and robbed the Spanish some more, and were able to pay back the investors, which was great. But the 105 men they left behind in 1585 were under the direction of Ralph Lane, who's a complete psychopath. He had done all kinds of horrific, even by 16th century standards, he was just terrible, not only to the American Indians, but over in Ireland, really everywhere he went. He was just a horrible person. And he wanted the glory. He's the kind of person that looks up to someone like Cortez. He ended up murdering the chief of the Secotan under a flag of truce, and shot him in the back twice, and then cut his head off. There's actually an Irishman in Edward Nugent that cut his head off, but the Croatoan helped the English do this. They were there. Manio was there, and Ralph Lane, there's a line in his own narrative where he wrote with his own hand where he says he was careful watching for Manio and his friends to make sure none of them got hurt because they are not Secotan, which is throughout the sources crystal clear. And I don't know why it's taken so long for people to understand that, but my book is probably the first one that lays that out and explains why it's important. He also burned a village down, and it just went completely in a downward spiral in 1585. When their resupply was late coming in 1585, and the 85 voyage kind of bled into 86 a little bit. It's confusing because back then that New Year's Day was in March.
Right.
So they ended up leaving with Francis Drake, who happened to stop by. It makes the story so much cooler to get a cameo appearance and someone like that. But their resupply, which was late, did not know that Francis Drake had picked them up. So when they got there, they also did not know that their relationship with the Secotan Indians had gone down the toilet. Mm-hmm. So they're basically jumping headfirst into a wood chipper and had no idea this resupply mission in 1586. They dropped off 15 men with enough supplies to last for 2 years. And they dropped them at Roanoke Island. And that's not a good place to be because it's right next to Dasacomonico, which is today called Man's Harbor. It's only 2 miles from Roanoke by water. And you can see it from either side. You can see the other one. And they got attacked. And one of them was shot through the mouth with an arrow and killed. And one of them had his head bashed in, and they lit their houses on fire. The Secotan Indians did. Mm-hmm. So that's a key thing to remember. And when your lost colony comes in the next year in 1587, they wanted to go up near where you are to Chesapeake Bay, not necessarily Chesapeake, but somewhere in the Chesapeake Bay, because they knew about it. They knew there was a deep harbor there, and it makes a lot more sense to put a colony up there if you're going to have a lot of deep draft ships. Hatteras Island makes more sense if you want to pirate people because of where it is. So the geography is kind of dictating all of this. And they stopped by Roanoke Island to pick up these 15 men from the year before who they don't know are dead. And they find a skeleton of one of them. And then one of your lost colonists, his name is George Howe, is by himself crabbing, and he got killed by the Secotan Indians as well. And they didn't just kill him. They sent a message. They shot him 16 times with arrows and then smashed his brains all over the marsh with wooden swords. When this event happened, and this is a key thing to understand right here, is the English reaction to this tells you a lot. They sent Manio and 25 Englishmen to Croatoan to get help, to find out what happened to their 15 men, to find out who had killed George Howe. And this is when they learned that it was the Secotan, which was no surprise given what had happened a year before. And they asked the Croatoan, can you talk to them for us and try to smooth this over? And we'll forgive them for killing George Howe and the other guys. If they can forgive us for all the stuff Ralph Lane did, please explain to them that we're not him. We're more like the first voyage, and we don't want to fight anybody. But, you know, if they don't want to be our friend, or if we don't hear anything within a week, then we're going to kill them all. Because they are English, but, you know. So the Croatoan even said, you know, we need some kind of token or badge where you can know who we are when you find us off the island so that you don't mistake us for Secotan. You don't mistake us for Wingina's men, Wingina was the Secotan chief the English had killed. So they're not the same tribe, and it's like extremely obvious. And the Croatoan chief's name is Minnetonnen. They met him in 1585, and they heard about him in 84, that they didn't mention him by name. They said that he had been fighting against Wingina and was wounded three times, and they found a chief who was wounded three times and named Minnetonnen, and he's living with the Croatoan in 87. He's living with them again. The English don't hear anything for a week, and they go over to the nearest Equitan village, which is Daskamonoko, means peninsula in Algonquin, and they find the Croatoan had taken over the entire town and are stealing all the corn and all the pumpkins. And they say, this isn't exactly what we wanted. We just wanted you to talk to them, but you know, this works too. And Minnetonnen and his wife and baby are there. So you've got the Croatoan chief and his wife and his baby, and they're stealing all the food of their old enemy's town. And they give him a ride on a light horse to Roanoke Island. A light horse is actually a ship, for those that don't know. You know, Virginia Dare is born and Manny is baptized, and that part of the story is true. And, you know, the governor tells him, just write down where you're going. And if you leave for reasons of danger, put a cross under it, like carve it out into a tree or some doorpost or obvious place. So when I come back, I know where you went. Because it was obvious they weren't going to stay on Roanoke Island when they're surrounded by people who want to kill them. Mm-hmm. And this is usually where the story starts, and everything that I've said prior to this is swept under the rug and not mentioned at all. It usually starts in 87, and you know, so no one knows who the Croatoan are at this point because they leave all that history out every single time. That's not right, but I mean, you know what happens at this point. The governor goes back to England. It takes him 3 years to get back. Because the first year, Spanish Armada attacked. The second year, Governor John White was actually wounded three times. He was shot in the butt, slashed in the side with a sword, and stabbed in the head with a pike. Not the Spanish who did it, though. It was actually the French. England didn't get along with many people. Right. So he had to recover from that. And then finally, in 1590, he's desperate to get back, and he basically just hitchhiked with pirates. And they go to the Caribbean for like over a month, just slaughtering the Spanish and stealing whatever they can. And they kind of reluctantly say, all right, man, we'll take you over to Roanoke for this colony. And they get offshore of Roanoke. And to get to Roanoke Island, a big ship can't do it. So they have to get off the boat and into these little boats and cross through an inlet and then get to the island. It's dangerous to do that. Around the Outer Banks, we have waves here, you know, and a bunch of the English drowned, including the captain, Edward Spicer, who was John White's like only friend on that ship. And when that happened, there was a near mutiny, and they said, we just want to go home. We're leaving. And John White was able to convince them not to do that. And he let them try. They let him try again. And this time they make it across the inlet. They get to Roanoke Island. The houses are gone. You know, all of that. And there's a palisade, which is just a circle of like trees around the settlement. And on the entrance of it, they've written the full word Croatoan. And then a little ways away where the boats were kept, they've written crow on a tree. So they wrote it. I always imagine somebody writing crow and someone coming up to them going, it's already on the palisade. You know, like right. They wrote it 1.5 times, but there was no cross, and the houses being taken down, they didn't leave in a hurry. If they took all of that, they weren't burned. They were gone. They took them down. And it's actually easier with the wooden pegs and the way that they constructed the houses, and it'd be easier to move them than it would be to start over and cut trees down and do it again. So it's not too surprising. But when the governor saw that, it wasn't like he hit his knees holding a bar of kryptonite. Like, He wasn't bewildered by what that word meant. You know, he knew exactly what Croatoan was and where it was and why they'd go there. And he said so clearly in his narrative. And he's basically cursing out the Secretan for, you know, stealing some of his stuff, which they must have done as soon as they saw the colony leave to go to Croatoan. So he says that the master himself and everybody agreed to go to Croatoan the next day, weighed anchor and tried to go, but they never made it. They got hit by a hurricane. And they lost all of their anchors except for one. And back then, for I don't expect the listeners to understand 16th century sailing techniques, because why would you? But let's just say there's the square rig ships of the time could not make tight turns. That's about as easy as I can explain it. And they needed these anchors to help navigate when they got close to land to get around shallow shoals and things. They actually had people go out in a small boat with anchor. You can't imagine a ship, which is one big anchor in the back like a cartoon. That's not how it is. They have all different size anchors, and they've all got individual names, and they're on the sides, on the front, and the back. There is the biggest one is in the stern, but they would actually take the side anchors out, and they're on ropes instead of chains, and guys would go out on a raft with an anchor and then actually pull on a rope to help turn the ship tighter. And they were afraid that with only one anchor left, if they lost that, they would be stuck in the New World as well. They're already kind of irritated when Spicer had drowned. They were had already nearly had a mutiny before this even happened. And so this was like the last straw. And the governor, he has no power 3,000 miles away from England in the sea. When they say they want to go home, he really can't do anything about it. They end up shipwrecking in Ireland on the way back. But that's it. That's kind of where the story ends. It's the abandoned colony of Croatoan instead of lost, because it's obvious that's – well, it's at least obvious that the most logical place to look for the colony would be where they said they went and where they had a relationship with natives that was positive, especially considering the rest of the area wanted to kill them. So that's what we did starting in 2009.
So what differs from the main accepted narrative is the idea in the main narrative is John White didn't know where they went. Nobody knew where they went, and therefore they're lost. But what you're arguing is that John White did know where they went. They weren't lost. They were abandoned. And where they went was Croatoan, or Hatteras, as we know it today. And then from there, what happens to them?
I just want to say, okay, John White gave the latitude of the inlets of Croatoan. He's got it on a map that he made, and he mentions the island of Croatoan three times just in the one document that talks about Virginia Dare being born. How anyone could say he didn't know where that was, that's just bullshit. I'm sorry, but it's not like an opinion. He gave the latitude of the inlets, my God, you know? Like, right. He definitely knew where it was, and there's nothing in there to indicate otherwise. Sure. So anyway.
So the 50 miles into the main isn't just some guess. It's they went to Croatoan. They didn't go inland like some of the narrative right. You would see on the history channel or whatever.
I also would like to explain this. So Arthur Barlow in 1584 talks about sailing along the main looking for an entrance, an inlet. Main meant coast, not mainland. When right. You talk about sailing off the Spanish main, what is that? So, and then even if it did mean mainland, ultimately what he told him was, carve out the name of where you're going. I think had they written Chesapeake on a tree instead of Croatoan, people wouldn't have as big of a problem with it.
Sure.
But it's because it's Hatteras that they have a problem with it, because that is the economic rival of Manio for tourist dollars. So there's a lot of just political nonsense, and that's sad. Like, that shouldn't matter at all when you're trying to get to the truth.
Sure.
It's petty.
In addition to that, you mentioned some of the political. Would that be some of the reason why the Jamestown expedition, just 20 some odd years later, why they wouldn't have gone down to look in Hatteras in that area? I mean, the way the English had viewed colonization 20 years later had certainly changed. You got a different monarch now. You've got King James, who says we're not fighting the Spanish, even though there are some in the Virginia Company that did want to keep doing that. They wanted to keep pirating Robert Rich and them.
Newport did.
Yeah, Newport did, right.
Yeah.
But their focus had changed. So who cares what Sir Walter Raleigh was doing? We don't care about his colony. We want to forget that. We're going to start our own afresh and anew. And is that fair to say?
I I think I've heard other people say that, and I've said it myself too. And I think that's some of it is, you know, King James, he didn't have anything against the colonists. He didn't even know who they were. They were kind of the drogues of society, but he hated the colony's investors. Sure. He hated Raleigh. He tried to send him on suicide missions and he just wouldn't die. He tried him for treason and kind of not a real trial, and put him in Tower of London and eventually cut his head off. And he went after all of the investors. He hated the whole Tudor. They did kill his mom. But anyway, yeah. The other part of it, though, is this. When John White went back to England, he didn't go to the newspapers and say, hey, they're at Croatoan and it's right here. Because if he had, the Spanish would have wiped him out and killed him.
That's a good point.
He wrote a letter to Richard Hakluyt. And I know you know who that is, but for everyone, he was the court historian for Queen Elizabeth, as well as a mathematician and all-star everything. But he writes this to the court historian because he has to tell them where the colony is, but he doesn't want to go to the press with any of this because the Spanish will wipe them out. The Spanish were actively looking for this colony, and they went up to the Chesapeake Bay and searched all the way to the Susquehanna River and didn't find anybody and didn't have any mention of them by the Indians, and just managed to aggravate the whole area and ended up hanging some people. You know about all that. In 1588, on their way back to Florida, which is where they had sailed out of, they passed by Body Island, which is between Roanoke Island and Hatteras Island, and they saw a cow, which is not a New World animal, so that had to come from the English. And they were that close to making it.
Yeah.
But they thought that the colony had gone to Chesapeake Bay because an Irishman named Darby Gland that had run away from the colony. On the colony's way over to North Carolina, they stopped and robbed the Caribbean. They all did. All the voyages did that. And Darby ran away. And he runs up to the Spanish, and, you know, he's Irish, so he's not real fond of the English either. And he tells them everything. And he was rewarded for this by being enslaved for 7 years in the gallows, as right. That's how Spain was. But he tells them they're going to Chesapeake because that they were until George Howe was murdered and all that. He didn't know about anything that happened once they got to, you know, because he didn't come to North Carolina. He left on the way over. So it's kind of a good thing he did that because it threw the Spanish off. And so they go to the Chesapeake area and they search all over and they don't find anybody. So you have this account from 1624. So that's pretty deep into Jamestown, 1607, right? And it's by Samuel Percy, where this is where you have this mythology about Hung Son of Cock, or Chief Powhatan, you know, Pocahontas' dad,
right,
murdering the colony who was living with the Chesapeake Indians. And this was invented by Samuel Percy, and he said that John Smith told him that. John Smith, as you know, liked to talk about himself more than anyone prior to Trump, and he never said anything about that in any of his books, ever. So Percy made it up, and he put it in this kind of anti-Indian pamphlet, which, you know, this is a little bit after Opie Cancanoo had slaughtered 300 colonists, and speaking of Opie Cancanoo, John Smith did ask him about the colony, and he told him they're at Onekunen, which literally means great turning of salt water. And it's the old name of Diamond Shoals, which is where the Gulf Stream and Labrador Current collide at Hatteras. But he never went down there to look for them. And I think some of it is also because Jamestown was having such a hard time sticking themselves. You know, they almost starved to death, and they had help from Indians too, and they still had a really hard go of it. It is a huge, like, romantic mystery today. You know, everyone wants to know where they went, but not back then. It wasn't. They probably figured, well, we're starving to death and we're being resupplied every 3 months. This was 20 years ago, and they never got resupplied. They must be dead. So I don't think they looked too hard. And they could have been right. They might not have fared too well. But that's not what the archaeology says.
Right. that's where you come in. Because looking at all this, you said, well, if these pieces of the puzzle, as you're arguing in your book, if these pieces of the puzzle are true, there must be something in the archaeology to support what I believe.
Yes.
So what has the Croton Archaeological Society done to support that?
Well, I was wrong on one thing, because while I believe that they did go to Croton, I didn't think they fared too well. And my logic for that was Jamestown's 20 years later. If they were thriving, then why didn't anybody ever go up to Jamestown and be like, hi, we're over here? Like, even if they went somewhere else, even if they went inland, wherever they went, why didn't anybody ever go to Jamestown and say anything? Because they obviously would have heard about it. Like, the news of Jamestown would have spread through the native community, and nobody ever went up there and said anything. So I always thought that at some point during those 20 years, they died. That's what I thought, but I was wrong. And when we started digging on the Indian villages, you have to go this layer cake, right? Like, you start with today, and you get, let's say you get to 1980s, and you find like a Sony Walkman, right? And you keep going down, and you go through the Civil War, and you get all that stuff, and the cannonballs, and you get through down to the 1700s, and you're seeing, you know, French Indian War artifacts, and you get in the 1600s, and you got all the brandy bottles and Tidewater pipes and all that stuff, and you get finally get to 1500s. It should be a purely Native American site at that point, and it wasn't. So we've got all these 16th century English artifacts, and the problem prior to what we did from 2009 to now was no one had ever found the 1500s. There was only one other real dig that was done, and it was back in the 1990s. And what they did is they found a site from about 1650, and there was a handful of artifacts in that layer from the 1500s, which is interesting because you're finding artifacts from the 1500s, but if they're in a layer from 1650, you don't know when they got there. It could just be someone brought over a really old gun or a ring or whatever. Or it is possible that it's something the Indians hung on to for a while that they got from the colony, and then in 1650, you know, finally threw it away when they were getting more guns and all that. So, but that's not like a real solid argument either way. It's just kind of neat, right?
Yeah.
So what we did is we investigated a lot more of the island, and we found where the Croton were living in the 1500s, and it's just loaded with stuff from England. So again, there's another problem. How do you know it's the colony of 1587 and not a bunch of stuff that they got from the 1585 or 1584 group?
Right.
Because all of them spent some time on Hatteras Island.
Right.
Well, we solved that problem too, because we ended up finding their buildings, the post holes, rather, for their houses. And then we found their blacksmith shop, their coppersmith shop, where they're making their own lead shot. And this is not 1584 lived in military field tents, so they didn't even build houses, and they definitely weren't messing around with metallurgy.
Right.
1585, you had 30 guys that were on Croton for 20 days, and then they kind of shifted to Roanoke. And then you had another 20, 25 that lived there for about a month and a half with Edward Stafford toward the end of the 85 voyage, which is still at that point was actually April, which would be 86 because New Year's is in March. Anyhow, they were sent there to spot ships and feed themselves. And they did spot ships. They are the ones that spotted Francis Drake and saved them all. But they're not messing around with all that metallurgy and building all these houses. It's too many houses for one thing for 20 people. Sure. And I was surprised because I always imagined English would have their own little chunk of the island with a village that would be maybe near the Indian villages, but not in it. Mm-hmm. This was in it, surrounded by over 600, and it's more than that. This is just what we excavated, it could, I'm sure the Indian village goes for like a mile, but
yeah,
there's all these longhouse post holes, or there's longhouses or what American Indians were living in here. This almost identical to the ones that you have in Jamestown, that kind of Twinkie shape.
Sure.
The ones on Hatteras are a little more round. I'm not sure why. Probably because it's so windy.
Yeah.
We don't really know. But you can see the fire pits, and it's so cool, man. Like, getting in there and problem solved, you know? Everybody was just so excited, and the artifacts that we have are so compelling. And the people digging this up are professionals. You know, Dr. Horton has dug all over the world. He's digging in Africa right now. And he brought in Dr. Henry Wright, who's probably the most famous American archaeologist. I guess Kelso is now because of all the TV he does. But, I like him too. But
sure.
I don't want to just keep dropping names. But, you know, Bruce Kaiser, the guy that invented the XRF machine, was there. And he brought it with him, and we're looking at the glass, and like, we have glass arrowheads where all this stuff gets repurposed. That I thought that was like a cool story in and of itself, where things, you can see where this pretentious plate or whatever was more useful as a bunch of arrowheads, and and this earring are going to shape it like a fish hook, and what it's even the gun barrels and thing, everything is repurposed, where they're just desperately trying to make it. This does go along with what the Hatteras tribe told John Lawson when he visited, you know, 100 years later. Mm-hmm. And he said there was blue-eyed Indians there wearing English clothes who told him their ancestors were white people who could speak out of a book, and which I always took to mean they could read. And they even mentioned Sir Walter Raleigh by name. Lawson, though, that's 100 years later, so that's kind of weak sauce as well. You know, you can't ignore it because it is, you know, believable what he found, because he did not want to find it. He was appalled by it, because he goes on to say how horrible that is that they had to do that. Late in his life, Lawson was an advocate for American Indians and really wrote some poetic, I guess, arguments in their favor. And then, ironically, he was tortured to death by Tuscarora, but, you know, that's history, isn't it?
Now, you found quite a few things, and at the end of your book, you talked about some future work the Croatoan Archaeological Society is going to be doing. Can you tell us about that? What's up, Colin?
Yeah, so the belief is that there was a survivor's camp, I guess you won't call it, where, because the colony doesn't know that they're lost. They don't know that no one's coming back. So, yes, at some point they figured that out and went totally native and moved into the Indian village and built houses. We can see that. But we still have this belief that before that, they had their own little chunk of the island, at least when they believed that someone was still coming back for them. And we believe we found that. And the story behind that is pretty interesting. And it's unbelievable, but, you know, if I wasn't there, I wouldn't believe it myself. But I'd like to tell you that story, if you don't mind. So Nick Knowles from the BBC was at our dig. He's friends with Dr. Horton, and he and myself and Dr. Mark Horton went up to Roanoke Island to talk to the Park Service. And we didn't tell them what we've been finding yet. We just wanted a tour of what they had found to see if we had anything similar. And we said, what's the best evidence of 16th century presence here on Roanoke Island from the English? And they showed us these three Nuremberg tokens. Like, this is the best evidence. We also have some copper slag and some crucibles, but this is the best stuff. These tokens right here, made by a man named Hans Schultz. They've got holes drilled in them, and they went on and on about it. And that's cool, man. I was like, man, that's really awesome.
Let me just jump in with my listeners. This was the most fascinating part of your book. I couldn't stop reading. I enjoyed it immensely up until this point. But then when I got to this point, I'm like, this is fascinating right here. So
this happened. I swear to God, this happened, what I'm about to tell you. And it's really hard to swallow, but I swear to God, I'm not making this up. So we looked at these tokens. We're like, that's impressive. And I told Dr. Horton, I said, you know, they found one of these in Hatteras Island first. He says, yeah, I know. And the 1930s, one of these Nuremberg tokens was found on Hatteras Island. And I didn't know it at the time, but it turned out the guy that found that, his name's Tandy, was my fourth grade teacher's dad. So, and he had died, but she's still around, so I went and asked her about it. And, you know, the Park Service found theirs in the 50s when they were building that fort. But what you see is Fort Raleigh when you visit the Park Service, Fort Raleigh Park, where is they built that with a backhoe in the 50s. Tourists stand around it in reverence, like, wow, this earthwork's been here for 400 years, but they built it in the 50s.
Right.
And that's when they found the tokens, which made it kind of like, yeah, they are 16th century, but you didn't find them in that layer cake, so there's not that context that we were talking about earlier. The one in Hatteras didn't either, because this guy found it, you know, it's just like regular guy found it on accident. Don't even know what he was doing when he found it. Yeah. And she didn't remember either, his daughter. So that token, the one from Hatteras in the 30s, was given to an archaeologist named William Hagg in the 50s. And he had written down where it was found because he asked Tandy himself. And we were moving a bookshelf in the Hatteras Library, and we found Hagg's manuscript underneath it.
Yeah, it's just wild.
And we looked in there. I know. And it had the latitude and longitude of where this thing was found. So we went out there. And at this point, we had already found a bunch of lost colony stuff. So Nat Geo was at the site, not the film, but the magazine. And Discovery Channel was there, which was kind of a snafu on our part because they don't want to be there at the same time. So we're like, well, what are we going to do with Discovery Channel? We're like, well, you know, they have this really awesome drone that can see different levels of chlor. We're like, ooh, let's take the drone over to where the token was. And, you know, if nothing's there, oh well, but let's look, because the token was not found in the Indian villages. It was found just wherever. We went over there with the drone. And this is on TV. It's on the episode of Mysteries of the Missing, hosted by, forgot his name, O'Quinn, that the dude, the bald guy from Lost, Robert O'Quinn. Anyway, we found a fort with this drone where the token had been underground with the drone. And I was like, you're shitting me, man. Like, this cannot be happening. And they got it all plugged into a laptop and a bunch of science I don't really understand. I'm not going to pretend to. But everybody, all his colleagues, Dr. Horton, they're flipping out, like looking at this. And we went and measured it. And it makes perfect sense. Like, now that we know, we're like, oh, yeah. That I don't want to give away the geography of exactly where it is because of looters and stuff. But it's in the perfect spot. It's just mint. I can't believe I didn't think of it before.
Yeah.
And then this is even better. So on Good Friday, right before Easter, we're digging in the Indian village, and Nick Knowles pulls out a Nuremberg token from the sifter. We've just found one. We're like, holy crap, man. But this is the first Nuremberg token found ever in context. And we found it in a Croatoan Indian village in the 16th century layer. Pops out this token right after we've done all this mess. So
right.
That kind of validated the other four of them, because now we found one in context. And get this. So there's two types, right? Mm-hmm. Say you got like a nickel and a dime. And then on Roanoke Island, they got two nickels and a dime, right? So the one that was found in the 30s from Hatteras matched one of the ones from Roanoke. Mm-hmm. And then the one that we found matched the other two. But there's actually hundreds of thousands of different types of tokens. And they have exactly two on Roanoke. And Hatteras has the exact same two. The odds of that happening are astronomical. Like, they had to be from the same source. So it's kind of this cool artifact trail. Even though the ones on Roanoke were found in a screwy way, it does show going from there south to here, and a trail of tokens, I guess.
Certainly.
So that was pretty awesome. And
So that gives you impetus to keep on moving forward with the work you guys are doing, and that's what you're doing next, right?
We were gonna do it this year, but COVID-19, and we have so many international people that it's hard to get flights, and we didn't know. We usually dig in April, so that was kind of the height of all the COVID stuff, so you couldn't couldn't do it. We could do it safely if we used all Americans. It wasn't a problem of distancing at the site. It was just the flights, you know. Some of the countries that some of the people come from were not allowed to come to the United States in April. So we just – that just really sucks to him. Yeah, to have to wait like another year. But
have all that excitement and just put it on.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
The plan is to revisit in the spring 2021 then?
Oh, we're going in for sure. I'm not waiting. Yeah, we're definitely going to do it, but we're going to dig on the Croatoan villages as well. Why wouldn't you when you're already finding what we're getting? You can see and what the impact the colony had on the tribe. So we dug on another spot on the island that's even older, way before any Europeans came. And you can see a change in the diet. Their whole lifestyle, even a tobacco culture, everything changed when the colony came. And that's interesting to see. Like, it's the same. They're still eating the same animals. They're still eating deer and fish and birds and all that. But the amount is different and the percentage of all that, which I don't have the numbers in front of me. But I can say, like, in general, they ate a whole lot more birds once they got firearms. And you think about it, it's a lot harder to shoot a duck with an arrow than it is a shotgun. They did have shotguns back then. It's different. You just put a bunch of small lead balls to the barrel and fire, but that still works better than trying to hit it with an arrow.
Right. So it's just fascinating. Now, I've got to wonder, so with the work you guys have been doing, and it's become more and more known, National Geographic, Discovery Channel, I read some of this. I read the National Geographic a few years. Was it 2 years ago when that article came out?
Yeah, two or three.
Yeah, so. And then recently you were in my local newspaper up here, Virginia Pilot. What kind of reception have you been getting? Have you been getting pushback from historical archaeological community, or more excitement and more focus down toward your area, or what's that been?
Yeah, everybody's thrilled. You know, with the exception of like four. You know, jealous, whatever. Like, everybody is excited about it because this isn't just me saying this. This is, you know, Dr. Horton and all this whole team of people are saying this, not just me. And it's, I think a lot of people that kind of knew the history are not surprised. And it's just kind of refreshing to have this come up, especially on Hatteras Island. People would come up to me all the time like, well, we always knew this. And they did, like, long before we started digging. While I was talking to all the old timers stuff trying to figure out where to dig, they all said the same thing. And they said the same thing in Ocracoke, and even the people that lived in Manio, like the old timers, like, well, you know, they went to Buxton, which is on Hatteras Island. I was like, yes, but I'm surprised that you know that. But it's because it's in the primary sources. If you read it and you're from the area, and when they're describing the different creeks and points and stuff, if you're already from here and you have that intimate knowledge of this place, you can use deduction and figure out where they are very easily. But for a historian that's sitting in Ireland or Nebraska or something, they're at a disadvantage. And I think that's one of the advantages that I had because I'm from the island. Everyone from the Outer Banks, I mean, like 99% of the people, probably higher, you know, 99.9, are all like saying the same thing. Well, we already knew that. We always knew that. Everybody knew they went down there because the Indians didn't die out in 1587. They continued to live on that island well into the 1750s. And almost all the old families are, you know, some Elizabeth Warren amount of Croatoan in them. And they've always just maintained that story. Always.
Right.
Long before it was cool to be an Indian, you know. And So everyone around here is just kind of like relieved more than, and then as you get further away, people are shocked. Like, wow, they found the lost colony. Oh my God. And they're just kind of thrilled like that. But even up where you live, I was in Virginia Beach not too long ago, and people, at least the, in the kind of the nerds or whatever, like in the academic circles, they're like, yeah, that's always been the most obvious thing, but it is very cool that you guys actually dug it up and it really was there. Because right. It's different to have a theory and then put the scientific method to it and actually find it is another level.
Yeah.
So I think most people are just thrilled. Sure. And the only ones that can't accept it are, you know.
Right.
You know, there's people who think the Earth's flat, you know what I mean? So you're never going to get everyone on board, but who cares? You
know? Sure.
I think most rational people can look at what's going on and see what the deal is.
So you don't take any stock whatsoever then of the going 50 miles inland toward Edenton and in those areas?
No, that doesn't make any sense at all, especially when you know the actual history. That's suicide. That's like
well, they knew nothing about the area at that point.
They don't know. Like, this is coming from people who haven't read the sources or don't understand the sources. Like, it would be like a Jewish family in Poland during World War II fleeing by going to Germany, except they can't even blend in. Mm-hmm. There's no possible way the colony is going inland. They just had one of their own, George Howe, shot 16 times with arrows and his head bashed in. Mm-hmm. They just robbed, along with the Croatoan helping them do it, the Secrets in town, where when Gina, the Secretary-in-Chief, who they murdered, or who the English murdered, lived. Right? Like, it's just stupid. Then, if they went inland, big key here, then why did they write Croatoan on the tree as indicated to do, as they were asked to do? And why did the governor say that he was joyful to know this certain token of their safe being at Croatoan, the place where Manuel was born, and people that island are friends? You know, and it gets to me, what's more important, honestly, is that the schools stop saying that Croatoan's a mystery word and no one knows what it means.
See, and I think that's a key, I think that's a key point, knowing that Hatteras was Croatoan. And if you know that, then there really isn't much of a mystery anymore at all. And what your work has done is prove that mystery is not a mystery, which for me as a historian, I'm excited about that. I'm grateful to see somebody putting that connection together and pointing that out.
Yeah.
Well, Scott, I think it's been exciting. The work is exciting. The book is great. How can one support and follow more of your work and what the Archaeological Society is doing down there in Croatoan?
Well, the best way to support my work is to get the book, The Lost Colony in Hatteras Island, but also CasHatteras.com, which is our webpage, CAS, and then Hatteras is HATTERAS.com. We don't update it a whole lot because you get kind of overwhelmed with people, and there's a lot of screwy people that are just trying to, like, figure out where you're digging and loot the site, put on eBay or whatever. So we're very selective, and if you go on there and we don't get back to you right away, just understand it's a lot of people trying to get a hold of us. So sorry in advance. Sure. But you can get on the site and kind of see some videos and read about what's going on and all of the latest news that way. Or listening to podcasts like this. So
yeah.
I think what you said at the end was really beautiful, though. Like, the key is understanding that Croatoan is not this mysterious word, and that without that lie, there really is no mystery. That's the truth. That's exactly right. The only reason that they said no one knows what this word means is that's the only way that you could have a mystery. Because if you explained, well, this word they wrote down is this island 50 miles down, and Manio, who'd been living with the English for 3 years, is from there, and there was this whole war. And, like, if you told the whole story, people will go, oh, well, they went there.
Yeah.
You know,
I think it's been great. Looking forward to more work here, especially when you get back into the work you're doing here in the upcoming few months. Hopefully no more sidetracks or hurdles to climb like COVID or anything like that, but or hurricane. Yeah. Goodness gracious. But
yeah, you saw in the book where we had some of that happen the first year. There was a hurricane and
like nature
kind of trapped them on the island. And then the volcano exploded in Iceland and the ash blocked the flights back. There's a lot of cool stuff in that book. There's some side stories where it looks like the Croatoan were harboring some slaves in the 1700s. Yeah. And we found evidence of that. And that's a whole nother podcast. But I really appreciate you having me on and letting me go like this. So
yeah,
thank you.
And for my listeners, I'm going to have links to everything on the show notes page, social media handles, link for the book. Great book. I highly recommend it. Nobody wants to go and read through David Beers Quinn. You don't need to. Read Scott's book, I promise. You'll get everything you need to know and more. And it'll excite you. It'll make you certainly want to learn more and continue to support Scott's work.
Thank you. Quinn did get one thing right, though. It is dreadful. 900 pages of Quinn is hard to get through. But yeah. In one of his footnotes, he did mention, he said Minnetonnen is one of the only Croatoan other than Manio to be named. So he was able to put it together. That was achieved. But he didn't make it very clear in his book. But when I saw that, I was like, the Irishman got it, and he's not even, he doesn't even live here. So he didn't have that that advantage, you know.
It's too bad he didn't get to know you. You guys would have put it all together back then.
Yeah, I think so. Oh, well, you know, I did benefit from his work. It is extremely hard to read, but it did help me, I'll admit. And, you know, I think that somebody in the future will probably be helped by what I've done.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, that's the benefit of history. You can build on it and learn and put puzzles together. Once again, thank you, Scott. I appreciate you taking the time out here on a Saturday night, and I'll be talking with you soon.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you for tuning into this edition of the Virginia History Podcast. Please help this colony to keep growing. Start by following us on your favorite podcast provider and visit the show notes page for each episode. Those can be found at vahistorypodcast.com. Next, please consider supporting the work financially on Patreon. And perhaps you'd like some podcast merchandise, or maybe a one-time donation fits your budget best. Links for all of these possibilities can be found under the support tab on our podcast website. Other ways that also help out are liking and following us on social media. Find us on Facebook at facebook.com/VAHISPOD and follow me on Instagram at Virginia History Podcast to see some of the statewide trips that I take for future episodes. I've also uploaded podcast episodes to YouTube. They can all be accessed by finding my channel at Robert Van Ness. If you haven't already, please leave a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. Doing so increases visibility in the Apple Podcast Network, the largest podcast outlet on the internet. Finally, tune in again next time as we continue our walk through Virginia's history. Do bad despedido dos embasês.